Welcome back, guys. This is Travis here, Fish of Hex. Appreciate you stopping in. Today's video is going to be part two in the 200-gallon frag tank build series. And in this one, I'm going to be showing you the tanks I chose to go with, as well as painting and drilling those tanks. I'm also going to be installing the overflow boxes in the return line, as well as doing some plumbing to the sump. Now, on top of that, I'm going to be also drilling the 60-gallon cube and painting the back of the 40-gallon breeder, which I'm using as a sump. So let's go ahead and get into it. As most of you already know, I decided to go with the Zoomed Low Boy tanks. Now, the dimensions are 48 inches long by 24 inches wide and 10 inches tall. Now, there's two versions that they have. They have the terrarium version and the frag tank version. And unfortunately, I wasn't able to get the frag tank version just because they weren't here locally. But I guess the only difference between the two is the lip on the top is a little bit thinner on the frag tank. That is what I was told. But other than that, they are exactly the same tank. Now, with that being said, I decided to start my drilling process on the 60-gallon acrylic cube. This was the freshwater tank that you guys have seen in the past. I sold the discus and the plants to a subscriber who lives locally here, so thank you for picking those up. And I decided I was going to just go ahead and drill this tank. I wasn't going to go all the way to the top, but I did do an inch hole for the bulkhead, which will drain into the 40-gallon sump. So the whole process there is that the left low boy is going to overflow into the 60-gallon, and then the 60-gallon will overflow into the 40-gallon breeder sump, just kind of continuing that process. Now, you might be asking, why am I installing a 60-gallon cube? Well, I have the 2.5-foot snowflake eel, and then unfortunately, I had to also put the blue hippo tang in there because I came back to the house the other day and she just picked up a ton of acropora and just started tossing them all over the frag tank. So she is now located in the 60-gallon cube. So we'll see how well she does. She's eating and swimming, no problem. But if she becomes stressed or has any issues, I'll probably end up selling her because she is a decent sized fish. But we'll see what happens with all of that. Now, the next thing I did after I drilled the 60-gallon cube, I moved on to the low boy tanks. Now, I do make a template pretty much for every glass tank that I drill just because I really don't want to take a chance of skipping the drill bit around. Now, I have done several tanks in the past where I started at an angle and then kind of put the blade up. I've also used the guides that you put on the side of the tank, but I just don't have one of those available right now, and I'd rather just take a little bit extra time to make a template knowing that I'm going to make a perfect hole without jacking up a glass. Once all the tanks were drilled, it was time to move on to painting them. Now, for every tank build I've ever done that I painted, I've always used the same paint, which is the Rust-Oleum flat black that is oil based. And I pick it up at Home Depot. It's only a couple bucks, and it actually goes a pretty long way for being such a small can. Now, I always like to use a sponge roller. I have tried a couple different types, but I never got a really good coat of paint. So the sponge roller just seems to work the best. I tend to do a quick first coat, let it dry for about 20 minutes, and come back and do a second. Now, you're definitely going to see light come through the first coat, but usually after the second one, you're good to go. One quick note about painting the edge of the tank where it meets the plastic rim. If you push a little bit harder on the sponge, it will force paint underneath, kind of filling that gap there. But usually, because I have a little bit of OCD when it comes to this, I tend to go ahead and put a black piece of tape over the rim at the end once everything is dried, and that definitely makes sure no light shines through into the tank. Now, I did end up painting the back and the sides of the 40-gallon breeder sump. Once that was done, I moved on to the low boy tanks, starting with the bottom first. Now, I did put about three coats on this, let it dry for about 5 or 6 hours, and then flipped it over on its side and then painted the back. Now, I was going to do the left and right side, but I figured there really wasn't any reason to do that, so I just stuck with the bottom and back of the tanks. Now, I know a lot of people tend to not paint their frag tanks, but I feel when you add the color to the back and bottom, it just kind of encloses the system and gives it, I guess, a dimension in life. I don't really know if that makes sense, but to me, I just have to have something on the bottom or the back of the glass enclosing the system because nobody wants to see wires or PVC pipe in the back of the tank. So I think painting them really just brings everything together. And as you can see, the sump is painted, the back of the acrylic tank is also painted, so it just kind of brings everything together. With all that being said, let's go ahead and move on to the overflow boxes. Now, I decided to go with the CPR retrofit 900 gallon per hour boxes. These are the medium ones on bulkreefsupply.com, and they're relatively cheap. They're not too bad, and they're actually pretty well built. They're solid, and really the only complaint that I had is that they have to be so wide in order to fit the bulkhead in there, but at the end of the day, it worked out because it actually gives a nice place for the tanks to go underneath when they're feeling a little skittish, so I haven't had to put any PVC in the tank, and honestly, there hasn't been any aggression because I knew where the bullies were, you know, from the main display, so I kind of separated everybody accordingly, and everything is working out great so far. Now, the first thing you want to do to set these up is kind of determine where you want your bulkhead to be. After I did that, I simply made the same spot on both boxes and went ahead and drilled them with my acrylic drill bit that I also use on the 60-gallon cube. When it comes to installing the bulkhead on this, you have to remember to pick up the additional O-ring. That's because you need to have an O-ring on the inside of the acrylic box, as well as one between the glass and the box. Now, if you forget to do that, it's not going to seal right and you're going to have a leak. So remember, if you go ahead and purchase these boxes, you need to get the extra O-ring. Once both overflow boxes were drilled, I went ahead and moved on to installing the 3/4 inch bulkhead for the return line, as well as the overflow boxes themselves. Now I'm going to go ahead and answer a question I've gotten before in some of these build videos is, why do I paint so close to the hole? Because I am going to be screwing that bulkhead nut on there. Well, the thing is that the paint actually helps seal the nut in place. And I know that kind of doesn't make sense, but when you twist it hard enough and you get it in place, the paint, you know, completely dries at that point and kind of holds the nut in place. And it actually makes it very difficult to unscrew later on. So if you plan on taking your overflow boxes off or whatever you decide to put on there regarding a bulkhead, I would not paint so close to the hole, just because it is almost impossible to get that nut off afterward. Once I installed both the 3/4 inch return lines as well as the overflow boxes, it was time to move on to plumbing the back of the tank. Now, I did not record this process. It took all day because I was in and out of the house, had things to do, so I didn't get around to recording it, but you will see the end results here in a few seconds. Now, just a quick note, I did make some sacrifices on my plumbing and it doesn't look the greatest because I have to keep the tank a certain distance away from the wall, and you guys will figure that out later why I did that. But pretty much I did add a few extra 90-degree angles, which does affect the head pressure on the pump. But honestly, that DCS 12,000 is straight overkill for this system because they are 900 gallon per hour overflow boxes. I have to install the reactors as well. So right now the pump is about under half pressure, which is roughly 1500 gallons per hour, and you mix that between both tanks as well as the reactors, and honestly the way the plumbing is doesn't really affect the overall flow to the tank. Once everything was plumbed up, I went ahead and did a quick test fill on the system, and there was no leaks and everything worked out great. So I'm really happy with the process so far, and I'm looking forward to getting some coral into this system. Well guys, that's about it for this video. Stay tuned for the next one where we'll be installing the frag racks, as well as most likely taking down the reef tank in that video. Either way, the whole process was overall successful. I didn't lose any coral thus far, as well as fish. So I'm very thankful that everything worked out that way. It was pretty messy. It was definitely a long couple days, but everything is going to plan and I'm very thankful that it's working out so far. Now guys, stay tuned to the fishofhex.com website because there will be a lot of coral coming up for sale, new coral as well as stuff that was out of stock previously. So check that out guys, it's first come first serve. And if you want something from the tank that is not available, please contact me and you can pre-order it. I will set it aside while it's healing so nobody else gets a chance of purchasing it. So just let me know. And if you guys like this video, feel free to give it a thumbs up. If you didn't, give it a thumbs down. Don't forget to subscribe for more, and I'll see you next time. Peace.